In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see you all here. I hope that you're all filled with lobster juice. I found it delicious. Just to do a quick announcement before the announcements, there's some left over. $10 a piece. They're waiting outside to sell them to you. So if you want to round two, go for it. They're really delicious this year. I want to congratulate myself before I start. For the week that featured Time magazine with a picture of our president with a crown on his head, not preaching about the Old Testament lesson. I'm not going to do that. What I do want to talk about is something that a different president gave a very famous speech about. A house divided against itself cannot stand. The president was Abraham Lincoln. What people don't remember is that it was given 2 years before he became president. And what Wikipedia doesn't know is that that's actually, he stole that quote from the Bible. You just heard it. But what he said in that speech is also true for us today. And that is, it is impossible to be anything coherent or whole unless there is a unity. Unity is very precious, particularly for Episcopalians. Because in some denominations, you get to join up by signing on a dotted line what you believe. It's a creedal formulation, and everybody salutes that same thing, and there is nothing but uniformity of belief. In the Episcopal Church, unlike some denominations, we believe that creation did not stop at the shoulders, but included your head. And you're allowed to have opinions, to have ideas. And we affirm, I want to affirm this again and again and again, good people disagree. The question is, how do you maintain unity if there's all this disagreement going on? And I can say for certain that we have no model whatsoever in our public discourse. Because our public discourse has deteriorated to the point where it's either my way or I'm picking up my marbles and going home. I'm going to dismiss the person who I disagree with because I'm right, they're wrong, therefore I'm good, they're bad, therefore I'm not going to have anything to do with them. And that spirit, Lord knows, has infected churches from the time of the Corinthian church, which had those kinds of things going on, to today at St. Philip's. We do not agree about everything. And my message to you today is, it's okay. We don't have to agree about everything. But what we have to do is not divide against ourselves. We have to maintain a unity. I think about that as a symbol. And the symbol is when you pray, this. Okay? My right hand and my left hand don't often agree. But when I'm like this, I've maintained a unity. Doesn't change or stop my left hand from being my left hand. Doesn't change or stop my right hand from being my right hand, but we maintain the unity. And that unity is precious. Jesus says in the lesson today that there is only one sin that is unforgivable. And that's a sin against the Holy Spirit. And scholars have for years debated on, well, which one is that? Well, I will tell you what I think that one is breaking unity. Paul says A sign of the presence of the Spirit is unity. Unity and the Spirit are together because unity is the work of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the glue that binds us together. We just prayed a discernment prayer that we're praying for, looking for a new rector. And it ends with united in faith and love. We make the Spirit united, unity. Does that mean we agree on everything?
No.
Let me give you an example. We were tasked by our bishop to take a look at some issues that face people in our diocese and to decide what we want to do about them. And we may decide to do nothing about them. We may decide to do something about one of them or two of them. But one of those issues was immigration. And so what the outreach board did was they tasked some people to write some papers to raise the issue. And we disseminated them. You've been reading them in your bulletin or on the website or any of the other places we put it. And then it happened. The threat to pick up my marbles and go home. If you do this, And the answer is, we weren't saying we were going to do anything. We were saying, can't we talk? And can't we come together and see if there is a consensus about something that we care about? And if there is a consensus, then let's do something about it. And if there isn't, then let's look for a consensus. We cannot be a church that is too childish that it won't have an adult conversation. And I swear to you, if you want a decent rector, we better not be that church. Our responsibility is to learn to disagree civilly, is not to threaten each other, but to listen to one another, to suppose that maybe, just maybe, that person who's got an opinion that's different than yours, that person could be right. I mean, I've been wrong before. It was a Thursday. I remember it clearly. But it's important that we learn to do that, that we learn to disagree, that we learn to be a community of people united in faith. We share that. In love, we share that. And not let the squabbles of the day get in our way. When I think about congregations that I've served that were healthy, I'll tell you a congregation I served. Remember the flap in the 80s during the Reagan years about Nicaragua and the Contras and the Sandinistas? Remember that? Okay. We had a group of people that came to me and said, we'd like to study about Nicaragua. And they called themselves the Central American Study Group. And they were clearly the people who were not on the side of the conservative vote, let's say. I had a guy in my parish who was a person who worked for the FBI in Cincinnati. He called me one day and says, I thought you'd like to know you've been reported for hosting a communist cell in the parish. So I knew the guy that clearly was the guy that reported me. It was not a secret. And I called up and I said, I got a great idea. Why don't you form another group and talk about what you believe about this? So we actually had two groups in the congregation, the Sandinistas and the Contras. Did they talk to each other? Not much, but a little bit. But you know what they stopped doing? They stopped hating each other. They stopped letting their politics get in the way of their church community. So my prayer for all of us as we seek a rector, as we seek to build a parish, as we seek very ambitious things to do, is that we learn to disagree as adults. And more importantly, learn to disagree as children of God. Amen.